The Essays or Counsels, Civil and Moral, of Francis Bacon, Lord Verulam, Viscount St Albans, 1625. The 58 essays and a fragment are followed by a short biography of Bacon by Alexander Spears, 1884. Read by Hayward B. Morse for Ukemi Audiobooks. To the Right Honourable My Very Good Lord the Duke of Buckingham, His Grace, Lord High Admiral of England, Excellent Lord. Solomon says, "A good name is as a precious ointment, and I assure myself, such will your Grace's name be with posterity, for your fortune and merit both have been eminent, and you have planted things that are like to last. I do now publish my essays, which of all my other works have been most current, for that, as it seems, they come home to men's business and bosoms. I have enlarged them, both in number and weight, so that they are indeed a new work. I thought it therefore agreeable to my affection and obligation to your Grace to prefix your name before them, both in English and in Latin. For I do conceive that the Latin volume of them, being in the universal language, may last as long as books last. My Instauration I dedicated to the King. My History of Henry the Seventh, which I have now also translated into Latin, and my Portions of Natural History to the Prince. And these I dedicate to your Grace, being of the best fruits that by the good increase which God gives to my pen and labours, I could yield. God lead your Grace by the hand. Your Grace's most obliged and faithful servant, Francis St. Alban." The Essays. 1. Of Truth. "What is truth?" said jesting Pilate, and would not stay for an answer. Certainly there be that delight in giddiness, and count it a bondage to fix a belief, affecting free will in thinking as well as in acting. And though the sects of philosophers of that kind be gone, yet there remain certain discoursing wits which are of the same veins, though there be not so much blood in them as was in those of the ancients. But it is not only the difficulty and labour which men take in finding out of truth, nor again that, when it is found, it imposes upon men's thoughts that does bring lies in favour, but a natural, though corrupt, love of the lie itself. One of the later schools of the Grecians examines the matter, and is at a stand to think what should be in it that men should love lies, where neither they make for pleasure, as with poets, nor for advantage, as with the merchant, but for the lie's sake. But I cannot tell. This same truth is a naked and open daylight that does not show the masks and mummeries and triumphs of the world, half so stately and daintily as candlelights. Truth may perhaps come to the price of a pearl that shows best by day, but it will not rise to the price of a diamond or a carbuncle that shows best in varied lights. A mixture of a lie does ever add pleasure. Does any man doubt that if there were taken out of men's minds vain opinions, flattering hopes, false valuations, imaginations as one would, and the like, but it would leave the minds of a number of men poor, shrunken things, full of melancholy and indisposition, and unpleasing to themselves? One of the fathers, in great severity, called poesy vinum daemonum, the wine of evil spirits, because it fills the imagination, and yet it is but with the shadow of a lie. But it is not the lie that passes through the mind, but the lie that sinks in and settles in it that does the hurt, such as we spoke of before. But howsoever these things are thus in men's depraved judgments and affections, Yet truth, which only does judge itself, teaches that the inquiry of truth, which is the love-making or wooing of it, the knowledge of truth, which is the presence of it, and the belief of truth, which is the enjoying of it, is the sovereign good of human nature. The first creature of God in the works of the days was the light of the sense. The last was the light of reason. And his Sabbath work, ever since, is the illumination of his spirit. First he breathed light upon the face of the matter, or chaos. Then he breathed light into the face of man, and still he breathes and inspires light into the face of his chosen. The poet that beautified the sect, that was otherwise inferior to the rest, says yet excellently well, "It is a pleasure to stand upon the shore and to see ships tossed upon the sea, a pleasure to stand in the window of a castle and to see a battle and the adventures thereof below. But no pleasure is comparable to the standing upon the vantage ground of truth, a hill not to be commanded, and where the air is always clear and serene, and to see the errors and wanderings and mists and tempests in the vale below, so always that this prospect be with pity, and not with swelling or pride. Certainly it is heaven upon earth to have a man's mind move in charity, rest in providence, and turn upon the poles of truth." To pass from theological and philosophical truth to the truth of civil business, it will be acknowledged, even by those that practice it not, that clear and round dealing is the honour of man's nature, and that mixture of falsehood is like alloy in coin of gold and silver, which may make the metal work the better, but it embases it. For these winding and crooked courses are the goings of the serpent, which goes basely upon the belly and not upon the feet. There is no vice that does so cover a man with shame as to be found false and perfidious, and therefore Montaigne says prettily, when he inquired the reason why the word of the lie should be such a disgrace and such an odious charge, says he, "If it be well weighed, to say that a man lies is as much as to say that he is brave towards God and a coward towards men. For a lie faces God and shrinks from man." Surely the wickedness of falsehood and breach of faith cannot possibly be so highly expressed as in that it shall be the last peal to call the judgments of God upon the generations of men, it being foretold that when Christ cometh, he shall not find faith upon the earth. 2. Of death. Men fear death as children fear to go in the dark, and as that natural fear in children is increased with tales, so is the other. Certainly the contemplation of death as the wages of sin and passage to another world is holy and religious, but the fear of it as a tribute due unto nature is weak. Yet in religious meditations there is sometimes mixture of vanity and of superstition. You shall read in some of the friars' books of mortification that a man should think with himself what the pain is, if he have but his finger's end pressed or tortured, and thereby imagine what the pains of death are, when the whole body is corrupted and dissolved, when many times death passes with less pain than the torture of a limb, for the most vital parts are not the quickest of sense. And by him that spoke only as a philosopher and natural man, it was well said by Seneca, "The array of the deathbed has more terrors than death itself." Groans and convulsions and a discoloured face and friends weeping and blacks and obsequies and the like show death terrible. It is worthy the observing that there is no passion in the mind of man so weak, but it mates and masters the fear of death. And therefore death is no such terrible enemy when a man has so many attendants about him that can win the combat of him. Revenge triumphs over death. Love slights it. Honour aspires to it. Grief flies to it. Fear preoccupies it. Nay, we read, after Otho, the emperor, had slain himself, pity, which is the tenderest of affections, provoked many to die out of mere compassion to their sovereign, and as the truest sort of followers. Nay, Seneca adds, niceness and satiety. Reflect how often you do the same things. A man may wish to die, not only because either he is brave or wretched, but even because he is surfeited with life. A man would die though he were neither valiant nor miserable, only upon a weariness to do the same thing so oft, over and over. It is no less worthy to observe how little alteration in good spirits the approaches of death make, for they appear to be the same men till the last instant. Augustus Caesar died in a compliment. Livia conjugii nostri memor vive et vale. Livia, mindful of our union, live on and fare thee well. Tiberius, in dissimulation, as Tacitus says of him, his bodily strength and vitality were now forsaking Tiberius, but not his duplicity. Vespasian, in a jest, sitting upon the stool, ut puto deus fio. I am become a divinity, I suppose. Galba, with a sentence, feri si ex re sit populi Romani. If it be for the advantage of the Roman people, strike, holding forth his neck. Septimus Severus, in dispatch, if aught remains to be done by me, dispatch, and the like. Certainly the Stoics bestowed too much cost upon death, and by their great preparations made it appear more fearful. Better, says he, who reckons the close of his life among the boons of nature. It is as natural to die as to be born, and to a little infant perhaps the one is as painful as the other. He that dies in an earnest pursuit is like one that is wounded in hot blood, who for the time scarce feels the hurt, and therefore a mind fixed and bent upon somewhat that is good, does avert the dolors of death. But above all, believe it, the sweetest canticle is Nunc dimittis, now you dismiss, when a man has obtained worthy ends and expectations. Death has this also, that it opens the gate to good fame and extinguishes envy. Extinctus amabitur idem. When dead, the same person shall be beloved. Horace. 3. Of unity in religion. Religion being the chief band of human society, it is a happy thing when itself is well contained within the true band of unity. The quarrels and divisions about religion were evils unknown to the heathen. The reason was because the religion of the heathen consisted rather in rites and ceremonies than in any constant belief. For you may imagine what kind of faith theirs was when the chief doctors and fathers of their church were the poets. But the true God has this attribute, that he is a jealous God, and therefore his worship and religion will endure no mixture nor partner. We shall therefore speak a few words concerning the unity of the church. What are the fruits thereof, what the bounds, and what the means? The fruits of unity, next unto the well-pleasing of God, which is all in all, are two. The one towards those that are without the church, the other towards those that are within. For the former, it is certain that heresies and schisms are, of all others, the greatest scandals, yea, more than corruption of manners. For as in the natural body, a wound or solution of continuity is worse than a corrupt humour, so in the spiritual. So that nothing does so much keep men out of the church and drive men out of the church as breach of unity. And therefore, whensoever it comes to that pass that one says, Ecce in deserto, behold, he is in the desert, St. Matthew, another says, Ecce in penetralibus, Behold, he is in the secret chambers. That is, when some men seek Christ in the conventicles of heretics, and others in an outward face of a church, that voice had need continually to sound in men's ears, Nolite exire, go not out. The doctor of the Gentiles, the propriety of whose vocation drew him to have a special care of those without, says, If a heathen come in and hear you speak with several tongues, will he not say that you are mad? And certainly it is little better when atheists and profane persons do hear of so many discordant and contrary opinions in religion. It does avert them from the church and makes them to sit down in the chair of the scorners. It is but a light thing to be vouched in so serious a matter, but yet it expresses well the deformity. There is a master of scoffing that, in his catalogue of books of a feigned library, sets down this title of a book, The Morris Dance of Heretics, for indeed every sect of them has a diverse posture or cringe by themselves, which cannot but move derision in worldlings and depraved politicians, who are apt to condemn holy things. As for the fruit towards those that are within, it is peace, which contains infinite blessings. It establishes faith, it kindles charity. The outward peace of the church distills into peace of conscience, and it turns the labours of writing and reading of controversies into treatises of mortification and devotion. Concerning the bounds of unity, the true placing of them imports exceedingly. There appear to be two extremes, for to certain zealots all speech of pacification is odious. Is it peace, Jehu? What hast you to do with peace? Turn thee behind me. Peace is not the matter, but following and party. Contrariwise, certain Laodiceans and lukewarm persons think they may accommodate points of religion by middle ways and taking part of both and witty reconcilements, as if they would make an arbitrament between God and man. Both these extremes are to be avoided, which will be done if the League of Christians, penned by our Saviour himself, were in the two cross clauses thereof soundly and plainly expounded. He that is not with us is against us, and again, he that is not against us is with us. That is, if the points fundamental and of substance in religion were truly discerned and distinguished from points not merely of faith, but of opinion, order, or good intention. This is a thing may seem to many a matter trivial and done already, but if it were done less partially, it would be embraced more generally. Of this I may give only this advice, according to my small model. Men ought to take heed of rending God's church by two kinds of controversies. The one is, when the matter of the point controverted is too small and light, not worth the heat and strife about it, kindled only by contradiction. For, as it is noted by one of the fathers, Christ's coat indeed had no seam, but the church's vesture was of divers colours. Whereupon he says, In veste varietas sit, scissura non sit. In the garment there may be many colours, but let there be no rending of it. They be two things, unity and uniformity. The other is, when the matter of the point controverted is great, but it is driven to an overgreat subtlety and obscurity, so that it becomes a thing rather ingenious than substantial. A man that is of judgment and understanding shall sometimes hear ignorant men differ, and know well within himself that those which so differ mean one thing, and yet they themselves would never agree. And if it comes so to pass in that distance of judgment which is between man and man, shall we not think that God above, that knows the heart, does not discern that frail men in some of their contradictions intend the same thing, and accepts of both? The nature of such controversies is excellently expressed by St. Paul in the warning and precept that he gives concerning the same. Avoid profane and vain babblings and oppositions of science, falsely so called. Men create oppositions which are not, and put them into new terms, so fixed as, whereas the meaning ought to govern the term, in effect, governs the meaning. There be also two false pieces or unities. The one, when the piece is grounded but upon an implicit ignorance, for all colours will agree in the dark. The other, when it is pieced up upon a direct admission of contraries in fundamental points. For truth and falsehood in such things are like the iron and clay in the toes of Nebuchadnezzar's image. They may cleave, but they will not incorporate. Concerning the means of procuring unity, men must beware that in the procuring or muniting of religious unity, they do not dissolve and deface the laws of charity and of human society. There be two swords amongst Christians, the spiritual and the temporal, and both have their due office and place in the maintenance of religion. But we may not take up the third sword, which is Muhammad's sword, or like unto it. That is, to propagate religion by wars, or by sanguinary persecutions, to force consciences, except it be in cases of overt scandal, blasphemy, or intermixture of practice against the state, much less to nourish seditions, to authorize conspiracies and rebellions, to put the sword into the people's hands, and the like, tending to the subversion of all government, which is the ordinance of God. For this is but to dash the first table against the second, and so to consider men as Christians, as we forget that they are men. Lucretius the poet, when he beheld the act of Agamemnon that could endure the sacrificing of his own daughter, exclaimed, "To deeds so dreadful could religion prompt." What would he have said if he had known of the massacre in France or the powder treason of England? He would have been seven times more epicure and atheist than he was. For as the temporal sword is to be drawn with great circumspection in cases of religion, so it is a thing monstrous to put it into the hands of the common people. Let that be left unto the Anabaptists and other furies. It was great blasphemy when the devil said, "I will ascend and be like the highest." But it is greater blasphemy to personate God and bring him in, saying, "I will descend and be like the prince of darkness." And what is it better, to make the cause of religion to descend to the cruel and execrable actions of murdering princes, butchery of people, and subversion of states and governments? Surely this is to bring down the Holy Ghost, instead of the likeness of a dove, in the shape of a vulture or raven, and to set out of the bark of a Christian church a flag of a bark of pirates and assassins. Therefore, it is most necessary that the church, by doctrine and decree, princes by their sword, and all learnings, both Christian and moral, as by their mercury rod, do damn and send to hell forever those facts and opinions tending to the support of the same, as has been already in good part done. Surely in councils concerning religion, that counsel of the apostle would be prefixed, "The wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God," James. And it was a notable observation of a wise father, and no less ingeniously confessed, that those which held and persuaded pressure of consciences were commonly interested therein themselves for their own ends. 4. Of revenge. Revenge is a kind of wild justice, which the more man's nature runs to, the more ought law to weed it out. For as for the first wrong, it does but offend the law, but the revenge of that wrong puts the law out of office. Certainly, in taking revenge, a man is but even with his enemy, but in passing it over, he is superior, for it is a prince's part to pardon. And Solomon, I am sure, says, "It is the glory of a man to pass by an offence." That which is past is gone and irrevocable, and wise men have enough to do with things present and to come. Therefore they do but trifle with themselves that labour in past matters. There is no man does a wrong for the wrong's sake, but thereby to purchase himself profit, or pleasure, or honour, or the like. Therefore, why should I be angry with a man for loving himself better than me? And if any man should do wrong merely out of ill nature, why, yet it is but like the thorn or briar which prick and scratch, because they can do no other. The most tolerable sort of revenge is for those wrongs which there is no law to remedy. But then let a man take heed the revenge be such as there is no law to punish, else a man's enemy is still beforehand, and it is two for one. Some, when they take revenge, are desirous the party should know whence it comes. This is the more generous, for the delight seems to be not so much in doing the hurt as in making the party repent. But base and crafty cowards are like the arrow that flies in the dark. Cosmas, Duke of Florence, had a desperate saying against perfidious or neglecting friends, as if those wrongs were unpardonable. "You shall read," says he, "that we are commanded to forgive our enemies, but you never read that we are commanded to forgive our friends." But yet the spirit of Job was in a better tune. "Shall we," says he, "take good at God's hands, and not be content to take evil also?" And so of friends in a proportion. This is certain, that a man that studies revenge keeps his own wounds green, which otherwise would heal and do well. Public revenges are for the most part fortunate, as that for the death of Caesar, for the death of Pertinax, for the death of Henry III of France, and many more. But in private revenges it is not so. Nay, rather, vindictive persons live the life of witches, who, as they are mischievous, so end they unfortunate. 5. Of Adversity. It was a high speech of Seneca, after the manner of the Stoics, that the good things which belong to prosperity are to be wished, but the good things that belong to adversity are to be admired. Certainly, if miracles be the command over nature, they appear most in adversity. It is yet a higher speech of his than the other, much too high for a heathen. It is true greatness to have in one the frailty of a man and the security of a god. As Seneca said in his letter to Lucretius, "This would have done better in poesy, where transcendences are more allowed, and the poets, indeed, have been busy with it, for it is, in effect, the thing which is figured in that strange fiction of the ancient poets which seems not to be without mystery. Nay, and to have some approach to the state of a Christian, that Hercules, when he went to unbind Prometheus, by whom human nature is represented, sailed the length of the great ocean in an earthen pot or pitcher." Lively describing Christian resolution that sails in the frail bark of the flesh through the waves of the world. But to speak in a mean, the virtue of prosperity is temperance, the virtue of adversity is fortitude, which in morals is the more heroical virtue. Prosperity is the blessing of the Old Testament, adversity is the blessing of the New, which carries the greater benediction and the clearer revelation of God's favour. Yet even in the Old Testament, if you listen to David's harp, you shall hear as many hearse-like airs as carols, and the pencil of the Holy Ghost has laboured more in describing the afflictions of Job than the felicities of Solomon. Prosperity is not without many fears and distastes, and adversity is not without comforts and hopes. We see in needleworks and embroideries, it is more pleasing to have a lively work upon a sad and solemn ground than to have a dark and melancholy work upon a lightsome ground. Judge, therefore, of the pleasure of the heart by the pleasure of the eye. Certainly virtue is like precious odours, most fragrant when they are incensed or crushed. For prosperity does best discover vice, but adversity does best discover virtue. 6. Of Simulation and Dissimulation. Dissimulation is but a faint kind of policy or wisdom, for it asks a strong wit and a strong heart to know when to tell truth and to do it. Therefore, it is the weaker sort of politicians that are the great dissemblers. Tacitus says, Livia sorted well with the arts of her husband and dissimulation of her son, attributing arts or policy to Augustus and dissimulation to Tiberius. And again, when Mucianus encourages Vespasian to take arms against Vitellius, he says, We rise not against the piercing judgment of Augustus, nor the extreme caution or closeness of Tiberius. These properties of arts or policy and dissimulation or closeness are indeed habits and faculties several and to be distinguished. For if a man have that penetration of judgment as he can discern what things are to be laid open and what to be secreted and what to be showed at half lights and to whom and when, which indeed are arts of state and arts of life, as Tacitus well calls them, to him a habit of dissimulation is a hindrance and a poorness. But if a man cannot obtain to that judgment, then it is left to him generally to be close and a dissembler. For where a man cannot choose or vary in particulars, there it is good to take the safest and wariest way in general, like the going softly by one that cannot well see. Certainly the ablest men that ever were have had all an openness and frankness of dealing, and a name of certainty and veracity. But then they were like horses well managed, for they could tell passing well when to stop or turn. And at such times, when they thought the case indeed required dissimulation, if then they used it, it came to pass that the former opinion spread abroad of their good faith and clearness of dealing, made them almost invisible. There be 3 degrees of this hiding and veiling of a man's self. The first, closeness, reservation, and secrecy. When a man leaves himself without observation or without hold to be taken, what he is. The second, dissimulation in the negative, when a man lets fall signs and arguments that he is not that he is. And the third, simulation in the affirmative, when a man industriously and expressly feigns and pretends to be that he is not. For the first of these, secrecy, it is indeed the virtue of a confessor, and assuredly the secret man hears many confessions. For who will open himself to a blab or a babbler? But if a man be thought secret, it invites discovery, as the more close air sucks in, the more open. And as in confession, the revealing is not for worldly use, but for the ease of a man's heart, so secret men come to the knowledge of many things in that kind, while men rather discharge their minds than impart their minds. In few words, mysteries are due to secrecy. Besides, to say truth, nakedness is uncomely, as well in mind as body. And it adds no small reverence to men's manners and actions, if they be not altogether open. As for talkers and futile persons, they are commonly vain and credulous withal. For he that talks what he knows will also talk what he knows not. Therefore set it down that a habit of secrecy is both politic and moral. And in this part it is good that a man's face give his tongue leave to speak, for the discovery of a man's self by the tracts of his countenance is a great weakness and betraying, by how much it is many times more marked and believed than a man's words. For the second, which is dissimulation, it follows many times upon secrecy by a necessity, so that he that will be secret must be a dissembler in some degree. for men are too cunning to suffer a man to keep an indifferent carriage between both, and to be secret without swaying the balance on either side. They will so beset a man with questions and draw him on and pick it out of him that without an absurd silence he must show an inclination one way. Or if he do not, they will gather as much by his silence as by his speech. As for equivocations or oracular speeches, they cannot hold out long, so that no man can be secret except he give himself a little scope of dissimulation, which is, as it were, but the skirts or train of secrecy. But for the third degree, which is simulation and false profession, that I hold more culpable and less politic, except it be in great and rare matters. And therefore a general custom of simulation, which is this last degree, is a vice rising either of a natural falseness or fearfulness, or of a mind that has some main faults, which, because a man must needs disguise, it makes him practice simulation in other things, lest his hand should be out of use. The advantages of simulation and dissimulation are three. First, to lay asleep opposition, and to surprise, for where a man's intentions are published, it is an alarum to call up all that are against them. The second is to reserve to a man's self a fair retreat, for if a man engage himself by a manifest declaration, he must go through or take a fall. The third is, the better to discover the mind of another, for to him that opens himself, men will hardly show themselves adverse, but will fair let him go on, and turn their freedom of speech to freedom of thought. And therefore it is a good shrewd proverb of the Spaniard, tell a lie and find a truth, as if there were no way of discovery but by simulation. There be also three disadvantages to set it even. The first, that simulation and dissimulation commonly carry with them a show of fearfulness, which, in any business, does spoil the feathers of round flying up to the mark. The second, that it puzzles and perplexes the conceits of many, that perhaps would otherwise cooperate with him, and makes a man walk almost alone to his own ends. The third, and greatest, is that it deprives a man of one of the most principal instruments for action, which is trust and belief. The best composition and temperature is to have openness in fame and opinion, secrecy in habit, dissimulation in seasonable use, and a power to feign if there be no remedy. 7. Of parents and children. The joys of parents are secret, and so are their griefs and fears. They cannot utter the one, nor they will not utter the other. Children sweeten labours, but they make misfortunes more bitter. They increase the cares of life, but they mitigate the remembrance of death. The perpetuity by generation is common to beasts, but memory, merit, and noble works are proper to men. And surely a man shall see the noblest works and foundations have proceeded from childless men, which have sought to express the images of their minds where those of their bodies have failed. So the care of posterity is most in them that have no posterity. They that are the first raisers of their houses are most indulgent towards their children, beholding them as the continuance not only of their kind, but of their work, and so both children and creatures. The difference in affection of parents towards their several children is many times unequal, and sometimes unworthy, especially in the mother. As Solomon says, a wise son rejoices the father, but an ungracious son shames the mother. A man shall see, where there is a house full of children, one or two of the eldest respected, and the youngest made wantons, but in the midst some that are, as it were, forgotten, who many times, nevertheless, prove the best. The illiberality of parents in allowance towards their children is a harmful error, makes them base, acquaints them with shifts, makes them sort with mean company, and makes them surfeit more when they come to plenty. And therefore, the proof is best when men keep their authority towards their children, but not their purse. Men have a foolish manner, both parents and schoolmasters and servants, in creating and breeding an emulation between brothers during childhood, which many times sorteth to discord when they are men, and disturbs families. The Italians make little difference between children and nephews or near kinsfolk, but so they be of the lump, they care not, though they pass not through their own body. And, to say truth, in nature it is much a like matter, insomuch that we see a nephew sometimes resembles an uncle or a kinsman more than his own parent, as the blood happens. Let parents choose betimes the vocations and courses they mean their children should take, for then they are most flexible, and let them not too much apply themselves to the disposition of their children, as thinking they will take best to that which they have most mind to. It is true that if the affection or aptness of the children be extraordinary, then it is good not to cross it. But generally the precept is good. Select that course of life which is the most advantageous. Habit will soon render it pleasant and easily endured. Younger brothers are commonly fortunate, but seldom or never where the elder are disinherited. 8. Of marriage and single life. He that has wife and children has given hostages to fortune, for they are impediments to great enterprises, either of virtue or mischief. Certainly the best works, and of greatest merit for the public, have proceeded from the unmarried or childless men, which, both in affection and means, have married and endowed the public. Yet it were great reason that those that have children should have greatest care of future times, unto which they know they must transmit their dearest pledges. Some there are who, though they lead a single life, yet their thoughts do end with themselves, and account future times impertinences. Nay, there are some other that account wife and children but as bills of charges. Nay, more, there are some foolish, rich, covetous men that take a pride in having no children, because they may be thought so much the richer. For perhaps they have heard some talk, such an one is a great rich man, and another except to it, yea, but he has a great charge of children, as if it were an abatement to his riches. But the most ordinary cause of a single life is liberty, especially in certain self-pleasing and humorous minds, which are so sensible of every restraint as they will go near to think their girdles and garters to be bonds and shackles. Unmarried men are best friends, best masters, best servants, but not always best subjects, for they are light to run away, and almost all fugitives are of that condition. A single life does well with churchmen, for charity will hardly water the ground where it must first fill a pool. It is indifferent for judges and magistrates, for if they be facile and corrupt, you shall have a servant 5 times worse than a wife. For soldiers, I find the generals commonly, in their hortatives, put men in mind of their wives and children, and I think the despising of marriage amongst the Turks makes the vulgar soldier more base. Certainly wife and children are a kind of discipline of humanity, and single men, though they be many times more charitable, because their means are less exhausted, yet, on the other side, they are more cruel and hard-hearted, good to make severe inquisitors, because their tenderness is not so oft called upon. Grave natures, led by custom and therefore constant, are commonly loving husbands. As Plutarch said of Ulysses, he preferred his aged wife Penelope to immortality. Chaste women are often proud and froward, as presuming upon the merit of their chastity. It is one of the best bonds, both of chastity and obedience, in the wife, if she think her husband wise, which she will never do if she find him jealous. Wives are young men's mistresses, companions for middle age, and old men's nurses. So as a man may have a quarrel to marry when he will, but yet he was reputed one of the wise men that made answer to the question when a man should marry, a young man not yet, an elder man not at all. It is often seen that bad husbands have very good wives, whether it be that it raises the price of their husband's kindness when it comes, or that the wives take a pride in their patience. But this never fails, if the bad husbands were of their own choosing, against their friends' consent, for then they will be sure to make good their own folly. 9. Of envy. There be none of the affections which have been noted to fascinate or bewitch, but love and envy. They both have vehement wishes. They frame themselves readily into imaginations and suggestions, and they come easily into the eye, especially upon the presence of the objects which are the points that conduce to fascination, if any such thing there be. We see likewise the scripture calls envy an evil eye, and the astrologers call the evil influences of the stars evil aspects, so that still there seems to be acknowledged, in the act of envy, an ejaculation or irradiation of the eye. Nay, some have been so curious as to note that the times when the stroke or percussion of an envious eye does most hurt are when the party envied is beheld in glory or triumph, for that sets an edge upon envy. And besides, at such times, the spirits of the person envied do come forth most into the outward parts, and so meet the blow. But leaving these curiosities, though not unworthy to be thought on in fit place, we will handle what persons are apt to envy others, what persons are most subject to be envied themselves, and what is the difference between public and private envy. A man that has no virtue in himself ever envies virtue in others, for men's minds will either feed upon their own good or upon others' evil, and who wants the one will prey upon the other. And whoso is out of hope to attain to another's virtue will seek to come at even hand by depressing another's fortune. A man that is busy and inquisitive is commonly envious, for to know much of other men's matters cannot be, because all that ado may concern his own estate. Therefore it must needs be that he takes a kind of play pleasure in looking upon the fortunes of others. Neither can he.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.